PC and consoles.
PC and consoles.
Yeah.
Okay, hi, good afternoon, everybody. Is this working?
Should be.
Okay, I'm Justin from Gattai Games. I'm 1/6 of the company. I'm the design and business guy. So, yeah, Gattai Games, I do like game design work and make sure there's money in the bank. So this is the team back at Gattai Games. That's me. To my left, in the picture, is Wesley. Then to his left is Brian. To my right, it's Dexter. And then to the bottom right is Andre. And to the bottom left is Weyman. So all of us do a bit of everything. And we're working on this game called Stifled. So the quick pitch is, Stifled is a mic-enabled sound-based stealth thriller, where sound is the only way you see, and the enemy hears your fear. So in the game, actually, I can just show you a quick like microphone video demo, and then you guys should probably understand what the game is about. So this is a trailer that we'll be using for our green light later. It's still not really public, so you guys have a snips.
Is this sound?
Yes.
You can use it. Okay.
Yeah, so right now what I'm seeing is like all these pulses are being created by the player's microphone. So when the player talks, right, it creates these pulses. Kind of low quality, I'm sorry. Because of like the streaming here. See anything here? It's a bit too dark, right? Yeah, it's a bit too dark. Alright.
This is the PowerPoint.
Let me adjust the brightness.
Yeah, so in the video what you saw was like we have like one voice actor was like acting through the microphone input and then it created the pulses. And again, when you're not making any sound, everything goes dark. So there's this push and pull between like because you need to use sound so before you can see the world. But all the enemies actually in the game actually hear the sound. So the more sound you make, the more you see, but it's higher chance of getting caught. So that's like the core gameplay mechanic of the game. And yeah. Okay, so let's continue my presentation. So because like the visuals are so unique and different, when we started the project in school, we kind of thought, okay, with VR being such a big hype, right, like, it would make sense for it to be on VR, because not only can we bring the player into the world visually, like inside HMV, we have the microphone input where the enemies in the game can actually hear the player, so that's like another layer of like VR, I suppose. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so we decided to go VR because the visuals are quite unique. We had the microphone which added immersion and it was good marketing hype at the time. I think it still is right now, but yeah. And right now, actually, this is something that I'll talk about later. It's after we work on the project for a bit in VR, we realized we should think about doing a VR first game, not really like a game where it's like we made it for PC and console and then now we're trying to adapt it for VR. So the talk would like kind of go into that a bit. So the biggest problems with VR, right, when it comes to sit-down games and games where it's not like room scale, not like HTC Vive, traditional first-person shooters, like controls and looking controls is not the most comfortable, there's a lot of live action, because what action means is when you see your character in game moving, but you as the player sitting down, you don't actually feel that motion. Your brain just goes haywire and it feels very nauseous. It's a very nauseating experience. So that's like the first big problem we faced when we were doing VR. The head tracking helps a bit, but as long as your human body is not moving when the character is moving, it's just not gonna work. So the possible solutions that a lot of like developers are using right now is, one of them is to ground the world using the environment. So games like Elite Dangerous, a lot of like cockpit style games, like I think PSVR, they talked about the new one, the X-Wing. So a lot of those games, the player is sitting down in a spot and the world is moving. I mean, the vehicle they are in is moving, and that helps alleviate that situation, the whole nausea feeling. The other game that does it quite well is like Budget Cuts. They use teleportation. So both of these things, we couldn't really use it in our game, because our game requires the players to walk very slowly through the level to experience the world. So that's kind of like an issue when you don't think about doing VR first. It's like you build a game and then you realize, oh, this doesn't work as well, and that's a huge problem. But then recently, Tian actually linked me to two links that we might try. So I'm just gonna like let you guys know. So if you guys are developers, it might be something that's useful as well. So the two things are dynamic FOV and tunneling. Okay, so we'll go with dynamic FOV first.
We present an approach to combating virtual reality sickness for a user wearing a head-worn display.
I'm just going to do a quick, like, so you can see right now the FOV is like shrinking when the player is moving. So this like reduces the load on the player's mind, on the brain, to like, okay, I'm seeing less, so I feel less nauseous. But usually when there's a lot of things happening going on at the same time, it creates a nauseating feeling. So this dynamic FOV helps. We haven't actually implemented this yet, but we'll try. So that's something that you guys can look at if you're a developer. The other solution is called tunneling. So what tunneling does is it creates the video does a pretty good job. So also similarly to dynamic FOV, what it does is like it creates like a static point where the players can ground themselves, and then the world moves slightly around. Yeah, this is something that we thought about, but I don't think it's something that we'll implement, because our visuals is black and white. There might not be enough stuff to ground the players, and it's not visually that good looking as well. It works, but it's not that good looking. Yeah. So the next thing that we learned as well is also regarding the related direction. Because our game is like a narrative-driven horror game, right? We have a lot of directed cameras where players, like, we get the players to wake up, it's slow cameras, players are looking into certain directions and all that. In VR, that's basically something that can't be done, because once you move the player's camera without the player's head moving, it's just instant nausea. So things like direct cameras, head bobbing, camera shakes, all these things have to be removed totally or like reduced to like very, very low. So the solutions that we are doing now, right, I don't think it's that clear, but the GIF, like we were waking up the players, like we want to do like camera motion, instead of it being full fledged of camera motions, we have like location. So you see one point, we go black, we jump to the next point, it goes black, we go to the next point again. So it simulates teleporting, simulates like the camera movement, but it's not actually moving. We actually made do without intensity grading. Previously, we wanted to do like still have camera shakes and all that, and let the player choose. But after a while of testing, we decided we're just gonna get rid of it totally. And this one is just more of a design thing. If you wanna do guide players in your VR world, try to use like visuals and sounds, because sound is. Sound right now, sound in 3D is actually pretty good, so you can play sound at the corner and it helps a bit. It's not the best, but it helps. Yeah, and then for our game, the good thing is like because the sound actually creates pulses as well, so it, the sound adds on with the visuals helps with the guiding. Yeah. The next thing is like head tracking when you're sitting down. This issue, I think right now a lot of people still haven't figured out, unless it's like a stand-up moving experience. So for our case, like, because we have a lot of tight spaces, like we want to like induce claustrophobia, right? We have a lot of like tight spaces, and players can basically look through walls, and that's not a very good experience. So what we're doing now, I'm not sure if the GIF is clear. When the player's head starts to clip into stuff, we slowly black the world out, and that just tell the players like, okay, hey, you're not doing something right. And this thing I saw recently, which I think is quite cool, so I wanted to show you guys as well. So this is a demo for body. They actually made clipping as part of the design, which looks super cool. Yeah, so I think that's something that you guys can think about as well when working in VR. So rather than it being an issue for like being a very bad experience, you add to that experience by using the bug, make it a feature. Yeah, that's basically all game developers what we do, make bugs features. So the next thing is workspace UI. I think if you are like a developer by now, this should be pretty clear for most developers that 2D UI that's stuck to the player's face is probably not gonna work because your eyes have different focal points and that doesn't, like if having something stuck to the camera, right, it just not doesn't allow you to focus and you won't be able to read the words or actually understand what's going on. So items need to exist in the world. So things like if let's say I have a UI that I want to show the player, it should float on something. Maybe it should float on like the wall, or it should be float at least 1 or 3 meters away from me, and that allows me to like better focus on the object and then understand it. So for us, because it's like a first person game, we have a cursor where players need to look at stuff and pick stuff up. So our cursor now is also like a dynamic cursor. So looking at the GIF, right, if you can see it, it's the cursor would be stuck on let's say a pillar. As it moves deeper, like further away, it will just pop to the further location. And that your mind will be, it's quite comfortable for the mind, like, okay, I'm now looking further. Yeah, so that's kind of important when it comes to doing UI in VR. Control schemes as well. At least from our experience, right, there's no like one-size-fits-all solution. Because our game is like a first-person game, we're sitting down. What works for me might not work for my other developer. What works for my other developer might not work for any of you. So our current plan is to like ship a bunch of like different control schemes so that players can choose what works best for them. Obviously, we'll pick one that fits most people in our opinion. And the other thing is also, I did something that I recommend as well, is consider reworking your control scheme to fit VR. Like right now, we're just using a standard gamepad controller. It's not the best experience, but because like of budget concerns, we can't really do much of it yet. So this is something you should consider, because having two-handed controls and having presence in VR really changes and uplifts the experience. So really consider that if you guys want to do something in VR. And this is just basic tech stuff. You're running more than two cameras. There's a bunch of stuff on screen, and the lag is really, really bad. So just optimize. Motion blur, we actually tested. Actually, it doesn't work too bad, you can consider. Yeah. So in summary, right, this is what I think I want everybody to take away from this, like, VR talk of mine. It's think VR first. If you really want to build a VR game, VR project, think about doing it 100% in VR. For us, it was more of like an add-on. I wouldn't say we regretted the choice, but it's more like we are suffering the consequences of trying to make shit work. So think VR first, and then look at, just keep searching online, talking to people, and then make sure like there's always a bunch of like solutions, different kinds of solutions that you can try, and just keep trying those, and you know, something like sync. So basically with that, my talk is ended. This is the GIF that I used previously as well. If you guys are interested in trying out a game in VR, just drop me a tweet or like my email instead, so you guys can check out the game before other people can check it out. Yeah, that's the talk.
Any questions?
Actually, related to this, though, I'm curious. A lot of horror developers have talked about it's actually tricky doing a scary game in VR because the scares are so much more intense.
Yeah.
Some people don't like it. Some people just won't do this because then a jump scare or something like that.
Yeah.
It should be so much people want to tear the headset off.
Yeah.
Have you guys run into this, and how are you dealing with it if you have?
So actually, I've read some articles where it said we should make our monsters about the size of a chihuahua, so it's not as bad.
Okay.
I read it and I was like, nope. I mean, if the player decides to want to play the game in VR, it's their call, and we're just gonna make it as bad as we can. So, I'm not gonna make it easier or less scary because a player says I might die. It's like you made the choice, right? Yeah. Yeah. No more?
Regarding the game, right, have you considered that if speaking to the microphone was a key gameplay mechanic, that since it's a single player experience, that it will start getting a bit awkward for you to be talking to yourself throughout the entire game, and users resulting to maybe just blowing into the mic halfway through?
Yeah. I think you did guess the game before, so. Yeah, okay, so regarding the question, we have thought about this. Honestly, I don't think the team, we haven't really come out to a conclusion. Right now, the team decided to like ship. The game is like you have a key input that can replace a microphone, but if you have a microphone plugged in, we would disable that key input. This is the current plan, but I'm getting a lot of feedback that might not be the best idea. So I'll try to talk to the team and see whether that makes sense. So it's possible that we'll ship with like the microphone input where it picks up your like talking and screaming and stuff. And we have like a gamepad input as well, or like keyboard input, and it simulates sound. So it's like it could be a clapping or it could be a cough or something that creates the pulses. Yeah. So that's something that we've been still thinking about. Yeah. That's one there.
Can I check if there are quantifiable limitations on like the polygon numbers in the scene that for you to run this VR game mostly on the mobile device?
Our game, we're not building for mobile. It's purely a PC and console title. Polygon-wise, I've not been in development for quite a while, so I'm not very sure. But I think we deal with like million plus is usually okay. Yeah, that's what you're asking. But I'm not the best person to ask right now. You can drop me an email, then I'll give you like a better answer once I get from the team. Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah. Oh, there's one there.
Out of a typical 10 people, general public, users here and so forth, what would be your estimate of how many will suffer motion sickness?
Out of like people that don't play VR at all?
Cross-section.
Okay.
Casual users, intermittent users.
If you, to be honest, I would think 7, 8, it's that much, yeah.
7, 8 suffer it or don't suffer it?
Suffer it, yeah. It's quite bad. I would think so, yeah. So it's something that we're trying to solve as much as we can. Yeah, so right now we don't have a proper solution. Like even we ourselves as developers, it's like, I'm fine, but my other designer is like, I can't do emotions. Like I play first person games and I really feel the motion sickness, so VR just makes it worse. So right now, I wouldn't be confident to say that we have solved it. It's like, 8-9 people, it's 7-8-9 people, it's a pretty fair amount. Yeah, so we're working at it, yeah. Oh, there's one here.
Do you have plans to make a game switch between 2D normal playing mode and headset mode?
Yeah, so the current plan is like there you can in game change it to 2D, just a 2D game. It's largely so that players, like, they don't feel well in the game, halfway they can just swap it out. So I think most VR games right now, at least the sit-down ones, they recommend about 30 minutes to 45 minutes gameplay time maximum. So that's currently our recommendation as well. So if you want to play the game, you're not feeling well, just go to the options menu, you can turn it off, and you can go back to playing 2D. And once you're feeling better, you can come back to VR if you want to. Yeah.
options, don't worry. Oh, okay, cool. Some more, yeah.
Have you actually implemented dynamic FOV?
So that's something that I've told the team that we're going to do. So this should happen sometime this week. Yeah. So we'll be implementing it this week to see what happens. So I think it's something that will work. Because, our game, because of the black and white, right, a lot of people already said it's not as nauseating as a lot of, like, full-colored games because the amount of information they have to process is actually lesser. So if we were to remove even more information, I think that would be even more helpful. Yeah. So I think dynamic FOV is something that the team all agrees that it's something that we should try for now. Yeah. So we'll let you know. Yeah.
Yeah.
Sorry, that's us. For the dynamic FOV, the purpose to reduce the amount of detail that was able to load in the scene, right?
Yeah.
Does it work in the same philosophy as bring down the level of the details you load the scene?
It's more how to put it. Okay, the whole dynamic FOV, the idea, right, is to remove the amount of details around the area so, like, the player's mind can process it better. So essentially, that's the main thing. And I think if you simplify your world, I think it will help as well. But there's something to be said between, like, some games trying to push, like, the reality. Because, like, once you go into a world, it's like, if it obviously isn't correct to world scale or it's, like, obviously not textured correctly or it feels wrong, it's very, like, jarring as well. But in our case, it's not too bad because we obviously put a very stylistic over the world. And yeah, so I'm not sure if that answers the question. Yeah.
Pretty much.
Okay, cool. Yep, back there.
What's your main role in the development team?
So in Gattai Games, I started off doing like game design work. I was a designer. And then I do like art stuff, UI stuff. But now I'm mostly focused on like business. So like all the marketing stuff, it's my job. So everybody is upstairs working super hard on the game and I'm just here talking to people. Yeah, it's weird. Yeah. Cool. Is there? Wait. Is there no host to save me or something? Is there? Are we done? Where's it? Yeah, okay, woo! Thank you!